an herb called ashwagandha that becomes more effective over time at relieving stress. So later, your whole body feels like... until eventually your whole world feels like... so turn your stressed life into your best life and become a stress baller with Stress Balls Gummy Supplements.
You know that an accident can happen in an instant, and insurance companies may push you to go to an auto body shop that suits their needs. But the law says you get to choose where you get your car repaired.
Hi, I'm Eddie Bacher, one of the good guys at NTC Auto Body in Fishkill. You have the right to get your car repaired where you want to. Ask your friends, your family, your neighbors what quality shop they recommend. When you go to that shop will work for you. If you get muscle to the insurance company shop, they will work for your insurance company. It's simple math, it's your choice, and it's the law. NTC Auto works with all insurance companies. So whether you're filing a claim or paying out of pocket, let NTC Auto Body's 27-year track record of quality, excellence, and fairness work for you. We are your friends, your family, your neighbors, and we're the good guys. Give us a jingle. 845-897-1777. That's 845-897-1777. Or find us online, ntcautobodyandglass.com. Y por supuesto, hablamos español.
Water. You can ski on it, watch the sunset behind it, or seek refuge in it and solace beside it. But the most refreshing water has a very particular label on it. Binny Water.
Hi, this is Marshall. Get Binny Water bottled spring water delivered to your home or office and stay refreshed. Available for pickup at 25 South Pine Street in Kingston or for delivery. Call 331-0504. That's 331-0504 or visit binnywater.com.
I heard Smoky Rock Barbecue has a brand new thing.
Yeah, it's the 5 and 5 combo.
I got that with some friends last week. You choose 5 of their signature meats and 5 amazing sides.
I love those brisket end cuts.
The pastrami is the best I've ever had.
The chicken and turkey, wow.
Plus all those sides to pick from, mac and cheese,
sweet potato fries, chipotle coleslaw,
dirty rice, baked beans,
and Smoky Rock signature cornbread.
But there's only 3 of us.
I think we can handle that.
We're hungry, underpaid radio personalities.
See SmokyRockBBQ.com. It's the American way.
My feet are killing me. I need to get better shoes. What are you wearing?
I just went to Montano's. You've got to go there. They have a huge selection, great prices, and they actually measure your feet to fit the proper size. They're amazing.
Montano's Shoe Store in Saugerties has the brands women love. Dansko, Birkenstock, Hoka, Morel, and Blundstone, just to name a few. They have the styles you want in the sizes you need. Montano's, where it's all about the shoes. Montano's Shoe Store, Partition Street, Saugerties, open Monday through Saturday. Montano's Shoe Store.
At Central Hudson, we're increasing our incentives to help you save now and in the future. Rebates for air source and ground source heat pumps can put thousands of dollars in your pocket. We also offer rebates on electric heat pump water heaters and natural gas heating equipment. And if you're looking to get rid of an old working fridge or freezer, we'll pick it up and pay you $100. Clean up with these incentives at centralhudson.com/incentives.
Summertime in Saugerties, where it's a good time to get a Jeep, Dodge, Chrysler, or Ram truck at Sawyer Motors during the summer clearance event. See the inventory of quality cars, trucks, and pre-owned vehicles at SawyerMotorsCars.com or come to the showroom at Ulster Avenue in Saugerties, a mile east of Thruway Exit 20.
Let Sawyer Motors move you.
Hi, this is Bob Sercasano from Sawyer Motors, and it's no secret that I love Saugerties. It's a great place to live, work, and eat. Why not celebrate with a great meal in Saugerties? Our restaurants need your support. Here's a few restaurants I suggest you check out this week.
Try the Village Diner on Main Street or Slices Pizza on Partition Street. See the complete list of great Saugerties restaurants at discoversaugerties.com.
Thank you, and hope to see you in town.
When you want today's hot country hits and yesterday's country favorites, there's only one place to go. Real Country Radio.
There are people in this country who work hard every day. Not for fame or fortune do they strive, but the fruits of their labor are worth more than their pay, and it's time a few of them were recognized.
Hello, Detroit auto worker. Let me thank you for your time. You work a 40-hour week for a living, just to send it on down the line. Hello, Pittsburgh steel mill worker. Let me thank you for your time. You work a 40-hour week for a living, just to send it on down the line. The hammer driving home the nail, for the one behind the counter ringing up the sale, for the one who fights the fire, the one who brings the mail, for everyone who works behind the scenes. You can see them every morning in the factories and the fields, in the city streets and the quiet country towns, working together like spokes inside a wheel. They keep this country turning around. Hello, Kansas wheat field farmer. Let me thank you for your time. You work a 40-hour week for a living, just to send it on down the line. Hello, West Virginia coal miner. Let me thank you for your time. You work a 40-hour week for a living, just to send it on down the line. This is for the one who drives the big rig up and down the road, for the one out in the warehouse bringing in the load, for the waitress, the mechanic, the policeman on patrol, for everyone who works behind the scenes with a spirit you can't replace with no machine. Hello, America. Let me thank you for time.
Here's Alabama. It's 40-hour work week in real country with Morgan Wallen.
Pour me another drink, 'cause I don't wanna feel a thing no more. Hell no, I just wanna sip it till the pain wears off. Pour me another round. Line 'em up and knock 'em down. Two more, let's go. 'Cause I ain't never heard like this before. Don't wanna think about her, or wear a ring without her. Don't wanna hit the karaoke bar, can't sing without her. So make them drinks strong, 'cause brother, she's gone. And if I'm ever gonna move on, I'ma need some whiskey glasses, 'cause I don't wanna see the truth. She's probably making out on the couch right now with someone new. Yeah, I'ma need some whiskey glasses if I'm gonna make it through. If I'ma be single, I'ma need a double shot of that heartbreak proof and see the world through whiskey glasses. Sing without her, so make them drink strong, 'cause brother, she's gone. And if I'm ever gonna move on, I'ma need some whiskey glasses, 'cause I don't wanna see the truth. She's probably making out on the couch right now with someone new. Yeah, I'ma need some whiskey glasses if I'm gonna make it through. If I'ma be single, I'ma need a double shot of that. See the world through whiskey glasses. Nothing's left to
knock 'em back, knock 'em back, knock 'em back, knock 'em back. Fill 'em up, fill 'em up, fill 'em up, fill 'em up. 'Cause if she ain't ever coming back, line 'em up, line 'em up, line 'em up, line 'em up. Knock 'em back, knock 'em back, knock 'em back, knock 'em back. Fill 'em up, fill 'em up, fill 'em up, fill 'em up. 'Cause if she ain't ever coming back, I'ma need some whiskey glasses.
Now in Kingston and Rhinebeck at 92.5 FM.
That hot old summer sun make you beg for your next breath. So you best be on the creek bank late in the shade. Like
This is Real Country Radio of the Hudson Valley. WBNR Beacon, WLNA Peekskill, WGHQ Kingston, and online at realcountryhv.com.
Good morning. You're now listening to Kingston Community Radio, airing on FM 92.5 and AM 920 WGHQ, Kingston, New York. This programming is brought to you by our listeners and corporate underwriters who are interested in presenting local community radio. The opinions expressed on this program do not represent those of PAML Broadcasting or Kingston Community Radio. Listeners are encouraged to send in $10 per month to help bring this program to you. Mail your contributions to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. For more information or to donate online, visit our website at mykcr.org. And good morning, this is Dan Gatiss, and thank you for tuning in, sharing the morning with us, being early birds like us. August 28th. Friday, August 28th, and 63 degrees here in Uptown Kingston, getting a little cooler. And weather and forecast for Kingston and the surrounding areas, sun and clouds mixed today with a high of 83. Tonight's a 70% chance of rain showers early, developing into steady rain overnight, low around 65. Saturday, we can't get away from it. 80% chance of showers and thunderstorms on Saturday, a high of 78 on Saturday night. 60% chance of scattered thunderstorms dwindling through the evening and becoming clear overnight. Sunday, mostly sunny skies, high 77. Sunday night, same. Mostly clear, low 52. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM and also online at mykcr.org.
Introducing a breakthrough in time management technology. A whole new day of the week. It's called Someday. It's ingenious. Perhaps someday you were going to go skydiving. Enter a hot dog eating contest. Maybe ride a mechanical bull. Now, it's on the calendar. You may want to retire someday. Ready for that? Then you'll really want a My Social Security account at socialsecurity.gov. You can estimate your future benefits, plan for your retirement, and how to save for it. If you already receive benefits, you can manage them online. Millions of people already have a My Social Security account. In fact, someone opens one about every 6 seconds. You should get yours today, because someday is here at socialsecurity.gov.
Hi, this is Cameron Rylance from Kingston, and I support Kingston Community Radio because it's informative.
And thank you for listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, WGHQ, 920 on your AM dial, 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. KCR is talk radio, your show. Call in 331-9255. And KCR's Radiothon continues today to keep the morning show on the air. We need your help. Please help us reach our goal of $12,000 by calling 331-1004 or send a check to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York. If we don't hit our goal, we will be forced to go off the air at the end of the year. The Radiothon continues until we reach our goal, and we are halfway there, so we're halfway through our Radiothon, or at least close to halfway there. You can also email at kcr921@gmail.com. Make your pledge today. And today is a wonderful Friday, and Heidi and friends are here. Heidi Haynes, Len Bernardo, and John Quigley are here to start us off. Good morning.
Oh, good morning, Ulster County, and thank you, Dan. And what a great morning it is.
Good morning, Heidi.
Good
morning, John.
A little bit chilly of a morning.
Yep.
But it's always good to be here with friends.
Signs of something to come.
Yeah, unfortunately. Really, it's just funny how you, when the calendar turns its page to August, you can totally feel it. It's just the weather. But I'm not complaining because it was nice to have a relief from our air conditioning.
Yeah.
Open the windows a little bit. So it's good to be here today. I have some friends with me.
Thank you.
Calling us Heidi and friends, you got to realize how we all became friends with Heidi. It goes a ways back.
It does go back. So I'm joined this morning by Len Bernardo. He's not only a friend, but he's a member of the executive committee and a local chair for Ulster County of the Independence Party. Yeah. And also John Quigley, who is the chairman of the City of Kingston Republicans, as well as our deputy commissioner for the Ulster County Board of Elections.
Board of Elections.
A lot of big changes, man, this year.
Yeah, a hot topic.
It is, and it's an important topic.
It's a very important topic. That's why, you know, John actually agreed. He actually wanted to speak about the process at the Board of Elections, and I think it's really important because it's a different time right now, and we've had some changes on a state level, and I figured we could have John on and discuss some of those changes, especially as it relates to absentee voting and early voting as well.
It's important to explore all options of voting that we have coming up for this election cycle. Traditionally, in an average year, 95% of our voters vote on machines. We're not going to see that this year. We saw in this past primary that roughly 60% of our people voted on the machines, and that was only out of a pool of about 14,000 voters. Whereas if you look towards this general election cycle, we're estimating an upwards trend of about 80,000 people. So the demand for voting in person and the demand for voting absentee are going to drastically increase.
Which is interesting because voter turnout for the Republican primary was larger this year than it was in the Faso-Heaney year. I think this year said 14,000 votes were cast.
Total for both races, yeah.
And in the Heaney-Faso race, only 8,000 votes were cast. Total. Yeah. So it's a pretty interesting problem because you wouldn't think that the turnout would be there, but it was in a different way, obviously.
And I mean, a lot of people had their concerns regarding going to the polls. Part of our job at the Board of Elections is to make sure that you feel safe at the polls. If we don't make you feel safe personally, I have the personal opinion that if we don't make you feel safe going to vote in person, that we're not doing our job right. We have to provide every poll site with the necessary equipment to operate and clean and sanitize as often as possible. It's not the easiest thing to do after every single person votes, considering the number of people that vote.
Pens and pencils.
But we go through every measure. Walking into the site, you immediately know you're going to take an extra step or two to help participate in keeping the poll site clean, going through the voting, and then getting out the door from wearing gloves, masks.
Can you explain a little bit what it's going to look like?
Yeah. We have hand sanitizer at every entrance and exit so that you're good once you put on your gloves. We ask that you put gloves on when you come in the doors to go vote, so when you're handling all the materials. We don't have to necessarily worry about wiping down every specific thing, but we do get to that. And so you'll wear gloves, your mask. If you don't wear a mask, we politely ask you to wear a face shield.
Will you be providing one?
We provide those to people who don't have them or to people who are uncomfortable wearing one or the other, trying to find it.
But it's definitely required.
That's an expense we wouldn't have had before.
No, neither is
PPE.
Yeah, all this PPE equipment, fortunately, is covered under a HAVA CARES grant that we have this year. And there still seems to be enough left that hopefully we'll be able to cover the rest of the expenses for the PPE for the general election.
So a mask is definitely required to enter the polling site, and it will be enforced?
In the primary, it was covered under an executive order. We have to find a way to hopefully try and enforce that for the general election. We can't specifically deny you the right to vote if you have any sort of medical condition that prevents you from wearing a mask for breathing purposes or any other medical reason. But those are just some of the ones that come to mind. So we technically can't say no to you as somebody who fits that category, but we highly recommend and suggest
encourage
that you help participate with everybody else by wearing a mask. You'll see all of our employees and poll inspectors are wearing them, and they'll check you in through the process. They'll wipe things down. We have those disinfectant wipes almost everywhere as you can find them, and we get you through as best as possible.
Good.
John, training. I mean,
training had to have been different.
Yeah, it had to be different. But also, in my polling place anyway, out in our ward, a lot of older people are the inspectors and things. Do you see any change in that, or are they concerned about being inspectors? Or, you know, obviously, you know, I'm a senior citizen, and I certainly worry about it more than the youth.
That was one of the challenging parts of this past primary. We weren't able to have the full 83 sites that we have in Ulster County traditionally because the primary reason was our inspectors weren't willing to work, and it was tough to get them to fill the positions with uncertainty. And we ended up changing the number of poll sites. But to keep on topic regarding our inspectors, this year we have been very blessed that there has been a well-coordinated effort, and actually Tuesday, September 2nd, is known as National Election Inspector Recruitment Day. Here in Ulster County, I can say we've probably gotten over about 150 to 200 new applicants.
Wow, that's great.
That's great.
Interested in working as inspectors. They vary based on age and their whole demographic profile, but you can definitely see a shift. Our average poll inspector is around the age of 72.
Wow.
Hopefully,
we're so grateful for them.
Yeah, you know, it's crazy, but, you know, being involved in the Independence Party, you know, we used to bring lunch. We had five election districts, and someone would pick up dinner and breakfast, but, you know, they're always right there, and again, they're not younger folks, and
they've been the most reliable, and the fact that they stuck with us last year when we introduced poll pads and electronic iPads for them to work on, they show how dedicated they are to actually making sure election process works.
We're having early voting again, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
Yeah, same location.
Touch on that a bit.
So early voting, we will have 5 sites for this general election cycle. All the information can be found on our website at voteulster.com, but specifically speaking, they'll be available in Woodstock at the Woodstock Community Center, Kingston at the Midtown Recreational Center off of Broadway. Let's see, the New Paltz Community Center in New Paltz, the Ellenville Library in Ellenville, and the Highland American Legion down in Lloyd.
Yep. So they stayed the same.
Yes, those were the 5 sites. Previously, I think we had 7 last year.
Yeah.
But it was very, very good turnout at these sites. We're looking to do our best to provide the early voting service to all of our voters. A lot goes into it, making sure that we're able to print these ballots on demand on site. We even got a chance to test that out this past primary, so it's well.
So a little bit on how the sites are chosen. I know that the state sets the amount of sites that need to be given, and then it's based off of demographics and connections to voters and whatnot. Is that correct?
In New York State, I believe the legislature passed a rule that requires one to be within a city if you have one in your county. So we look to have one in the city of Kingston. And then the next requirement, I believe, is per X amount of population. And I don't remember the population off the top of my head, but I think it's like 150.
150 is only a requirement of 2 early voting sites. And
correct.
We're lucky enough that we have 5 here in Ulster County.
And we have, on the voter rolls, we have 118,000 active voters and about 133,000 members on the voter rolls completely. That might actually be above 118 right now. You tend to see in presidential years a lot more people reactivate or register to vote.
Sure.
So that number changes, and you can see anywhere from like 3,000 to 6,000 people register to vote.
Have you noticed any difference in registration considering an influx of people moving to Ulster?
Lots of people from the city saying just got out of the city from COVID. It looks like we're enjoying it here, and we welcome them to Ulster County, and we're thankful that they're making sure ahead of time that their registration is following through on them. If you happen to be one of those individuals and you go through the transfer and you change your address to Ulster County, you'll be on the voter rolls. If you happen to be one of those people who forgets to do it before Election Day, it doesn't stop you from voting. New York State has an in-state transfer rule that allows those who transfer amongst the state to go and vote affidavit, and at the end of the day, we have to do a reconciliation process that makes sure that their record is brought to Ulster right. County. They haven't voted anywhere else, very unlikely, but make sure that everything is followed accordingly.
Early voting starts. Do you know the date off the top of your head?
Early voting starts.
Let's get them the date for early voting. I can't.
October 24th?
It's a Saturday, so don't get, you know, some people are surprised right, that we're starting exactly. on a Saturday.
It's a Saturday to the following Sunday. We do two weekends. The days for the times for the weekends are, I believe, 10 to 4. Let me catch that. 10 to 3 to be exact. And then through the weekday, it varies whether it's 9 to 5 or 12 to 8. It's going to be based on, I think, Monday, Wednesday, Friday is the 9 to 5, and then the Tuesday, Thursday are the late nights till 8 o'clock.
One of the things that I think that needs to be cleared up, because there's some confusion, and it was just because I was speaking to someone about it, mail-in voting. What happens is it's a two-step process, as I understand it, John. You could, you know, probably better expound on it. But first, you have to request, or you're going to get mailed. Excuse
you're gonna
me.
You're
going to receive an absentee ballot request, and then you have to mail it back.
So
the ballot doesn't automatically come to you. Is my point? Is that true?
As everybody knows, the national stage has been a very hot topic. And I immediately, when I hear the word mail-in voting, I like to stop people right then and there and say it's absentee voting in New York State, and it's thankfully absentee voting in New York State due to the New York State Constitution. It is enforced not by any of our legislature or our governor, but by the Constitution itself that allows us the opportunity to go and mail in right. a ballot when we are experiencing some sort of absence from Ulster County or
for illness or travel.
There's several like different that. Right. reasons yes. that you can
now,
request.
Now, not going to be in the county.
Yes. Now, to be specific about people's concerns regarding to the polls and their absence from the poll site, the governor, as well as the state legislature, passed legislation to help expand on the definition of temporary illness. Which is one of your options you can choose when filling out the absentee ballot.
When you needed to request an absentee ballot, yes. there was a few different choices of the reasons why you would be able to select, and the governor and the state legislature expanded upon that and gave the option of...
Well, they expanded on the definition.
To
basically mean that the fear of contagion would also apply to...
That's new. He just signed that.
But I also understand just by mailing it back... You don't really have to define what it is. That was one of the things that I thought the legislature talked about.
Well, so
you don't have to check the box, I don't want to. So in other words, they're going to mail, everyone gets one. And just by you mailing it back, entitles you to a ballot.
Having a completed application.
That's correct.
Does, yeah. And it's specific to that election cycle.
Only, correct, yep. Yeah, so no, you don't have to worry about checking boxes, just really filling out your...
Yeah, just run through the process again, though. So they're going to receive an absentee ballot request.
Well, no, you would have to, as an individual interested in voting absentee, you would have to contact us.
Okay, so...
That's not what I'm hearing.
This is where we need the clarification.
We do not mail absentee applications. That was only for the primary, and that was due to an executive order issued by the governor.
But I thought that was happening... It's interesting because Cuomo came out, yeah. I want to say...
An executive order on August 24th, a couple days ago, right. requesting that we mail every voter
in Ulster
County informational piece.
It
doesn't have the application itself.
Oh, no.
It has a way... believe me, it's a two-prong approach. It has a way for you to go on. Now you're allowed to apply for an absentee over the phone.
Right.
So if you call the Board of Elections at 845-334-5470, you can say you'd like to apply for an absentee, and they fill out an absentee application for you and then print it out, and it goes through our commissioner review, and that is your application.
Which is not a signed application at that stage.
Correct, but let's hold on to that one. then you have your emailed applications. If you'd like to email us, you can email us at absentees@co.ulster.ny.us. And you have to include your name, your address. It helps us if you provide your date of birth in the case that there's multiple John Correct. Smiths. As well as your reason why you're requesting one, and you can be as specific or generalized as you'd like to be. That email will act as a absentee application as well. The absentee application itself is available on our website. You can fill that out, download it, email it to us, mail it to us, whatever you'd like. There's endless amounts of options for those who want to vote absentee to be able to apply for us. And shortly in the near future, we're waiting on the State Board of Elections to release a portal that just go to the link, fill out the information, and it gets back to us. Tracking the paper when we had so many paper
you know that's
applications. Okay, before we move on to that though, I just want the listeners to understand that it's incumbent upon them to request an absentee ballot.
Correct. That's very important.
That's very important. Nothing's going to be your ballot's not going to be mailed to you.
No.
It's incumbent upon you as the voter to request an absentee ballot, and John gave you a couple of ways that you can do that. Probably the easiest would be to call Board of Elections.
And it's interesting.
Online is the easiest, but for those people who don't navigate online so much, you can call the Board of Elections at 334-5470 for assistance. And what is the deadline for requesting an absentee ballot?
That deadline, I believe, is extended all the way up until, well, so it depends. If you're asking for one to be mailed to you.
That's another thing, because how do you get your absentee ballot? You know, we take this stuff for granted because we
kind of live in this
world, but there's so many people listening. It's so confusing, and I don't want them to feel overwhelmed by the process.
Right. No, you're right about that.
We could talk about these things and paper and some. They don't know what we're talking about, so I'm just trying to really break it down for the average voter.
It's really funny you're saying that, because I was under the impression clearly that the Board of Elections was going to send you the request. And now they're sending you information. Right. So, which means that you have to apply online or phone call or email to get your ballot.
You have to request for the ballot to be sent to you. And you can do that online or by calling the Ulster County Board of Elections.
And again, that's just one of the three options to vote.
Go ahead with the other,
make you feel safe voting early. And then voting on election day are always still going to be there for you. The amount of phone calls, see, with all the information and the way things are going, people are calling saying, I can't go vote in my poll site. It's like, no, you can. Your poll site will be open.
Right.
We will be operating it, and we will make sure it is as safe and sound as possible. And they're like, oh, well, you know what? I won't bother even requesting one.
Oh, we have a caller. Good morning, caller.
Good morning. I have a question to ask you. Okay, I vote all the time, but the last 2 years now when I've gone to voting, I need assistance with it because I have a movement disorder. It's impossible for me to, fill in those dots. And now that we have the virus, you have to have the 6 feet apart. So, like I said, I need help to do that. Would I still be able to get that help?
You will still be able to get that help. And when you go to vote, when you ask for assistance, one of our ballot masters or chair masters will be able to assist you in that action. And if there's any action that they are taking, if you like to request that they have a new pair of gloves on or make sure that they're hand sanitizer with them to help get through that process, they will have a mask on or at least a face shield. That way they can communicate with you. They'll be there every step along the way as they have been in the past. And we look to accommodate you in any specific manner, but we will definitely take every step we can to make sure that you feel safe when you receive assistance at the polls.
Okay, thank you, because that's what, I was really concerned about that, because, like I said, the thing with, the distancing and stuff like that, that I still would be able to get the help that I need with it.
Yes.
Safely.
Yep.
So thank you for that, and thanks for all you do and all your good work, and it's good having you on the air, too.
Thank you for calling.
Yes, and thank you for calling in.
And that's just a whole other kind of rub to this. People who want, there are certain people who really want to go to the polls.
That experience.
That experience of making sure that their ballot gets in that machine.
Very satisfying experience.
It is. So And he, there's a wonderful example of a person who needs assistance to get to the pole. She wants to get to the pole. And certainly you guys are doing a good job making sure she has that opportunity. You know, we see all these memes. If you can go to Target, you can go to vote. Yeah, well, that's true. But bigger than that is making sure everybody has that opportunity to vote and no one gets disenfranchised.
Yeah, absolutely. That's, you know. And having confidence in the process,
right?
And, you know.
Well, that's a whole other question. Isn't that a whole other thing, John?
During a pandemic,
what's lacking confidence?
Well, you know, I got to tell you, you know, the joke is, you know, and again, this is something that we talk about kind of openly, is the dead people file. On the voter rolls, how difficult it is to get people off the voter roll.
Purge the roll.
Purging the rolls.
So this past primary, when we were mailing absentee applications to voters in the primary, the amount of phone calls I got saying, why'd you send one to my
correct.
Dead uncle? I was like, we need an obituary.
That's correct. You need a death certificate.
But we can refer to it based off
of you can.
Obituary.
Okay, good.
So there's a lot of different ways that we can get that individual off the voter rolls, and it's something that's done very regularly and actively. So I can say we do the best to maintain the voter rolls. They're not perfect in any way.
No, it's impossible to be perfect on anything these days.
Like, we are fortunate enough here in Ulster County that I think we do a very diligent job on both sides of the aisle to make sure that the Board of Elections functions properly and avoids all fraud. I mean, one of the biggest things this past election as well was the whole mailing in of the ballots and the timing of working with the post office and everything. You didn't see any issues here in Ulster County.
This was during the primary.
Right.
Correct. We've worked very closely. We've worked very long, long nights up to the point where we had to send out ballots. And yes, I wouldn't be surprised to hear of those stories of ballots landing after Election Day, on Election Day. Actually, we just got an email the other day. One of our ladies who's requesting an absentee, fortunately, she also receives it via email. She's down in Mexico. She didn't get her April 28th ballot until just yesterday.
Wow.
And that was for a canceled primary that didn't even take place. So, I mean,
yeah,
it's difficult to see the timing of things and how they're sent, and that's why I believe you had a question earlier about what's the deadline for applying for an absentee application? On paper, they tell you, we have to tell you 7 days before the election is when you have to at least postmark your application to the Board of Elections. Because of this pandemic and this mail flow, I think there needs to be an extra 7 days added to that personally.
So you're suggesting?
Suggesting that you mail in your absentee application at least 2 weeks prior, if you're going to mail it in physically to the Board
of Elections.
To
receive a ballot?
Yes.
Yeah, that's really even pushing it.
Well, the other side of the coin is, you know, you can have someone pick it up for you, too.
You can, and also, are you accepting people at the Board of Elections?
So yeah, that's why I want to make sure we get through all the options, because there really is no, the deadline goes up to the day before the election is when you can apply for an absentee ballot in person.
Correct.
We do have people who stop in regularly. Our office is open Monday to Friday, 9 to 5. We worked all through the pandemic, making sure that our elections were ready to go, because at the time, we weren't canceled for the April 28th primary, so we worked all through March. Mm-hmm. Then everything got delayed to the June primary, and we had to work all through May and June, full staff, making sure that we were ready to go. So we will accept them up to the day before. You can stop in person. You can mail it in. You can email it. And you can phone it in.
You know, we're coming up to the half hour, but I have another question for John after that.
Yeah, when we come back, we'll continue the discussion. Yeah, this is very informative.
Really, you are.
All right, great. Thank you, Dan.
Okay, thank you, Heidi Haynes. And we've got also John Quigley and Len Bernardo here in the on-air studio today, speaking about all of the necessary things for the Board of Elections and making sure your vote gets through. You're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. My name is Dan Gatiss, and it is 7:30 a.m., Friday, August 28th, and 63 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. Sun and clouds mixed today, a high of 83. Tonight, 70% chance of rain showers early, developing into a steady rain overnight, low around 65. Saturday, 80% chance of showers and thunderstorms, high of 78. And Saturday night, 60% chance of scattered thunderstorms during the evening, becoming clear overnight. Sunday, mostly sunny skies, high of 77. Sunday night, mostly clear, low 52. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
Adopt US Kids presents What to Expect When You're Expecting. A teenager learning the lingo.
Today I'm going to help parents translate teen slang. Now, when a teen says something is on fleek, it's exactly like saying, that's rad. It simply means that something is awesome or cool. Another one is totes. It's exactly like saying totally, just shorter. As in, I totes love going to the mall with Becca. Another word you might hear is jelly. Jelly is a shorter, better way to say jealous. As in, Chloe, I am like so jelly of your unicorn phone case.
You don't have to speak teen to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will think you're, rad, just the same. To learn more, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, AdoptUSKids, and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Scott Harrington from Hurley, and I support Kingston Community Radio because the people need a place to have their voice heard, and it's lost in corporate radio. So please keep listening and supporting our station.
You're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, 7:32 AM, 63 degrees on this August 28th. And it is indeed true. KCR's Radiothon continues today to help keep the morning show on the air. We're a little up to almost halfway there of $12,000, so we're almost halfway done with the Radiothon. Your contributions help keep KCR alive. Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402 to send your check, or to make a pledge, call 845-331-1004. Now let's get back to the on-air studio with Heidi Haynes and Len Bernardo and John Quigley. Welcome back.
Thanks, Dan. And the Radiothon halfway there reminds me of Bon Jovi. We don't want to be living on a prayer, but we're halfway there.
It's really important to support the stuff. We have to support the station.
And if you enjoy listening, please definitely consider supporting us and the radio show and keeping us on the air, so we can have these important conversations like we're having today. I'm joined by Deputy Commissioner from the Ulster County Board of Elections, John Quigley, and Executive Committee member of the Independence Party, Len Bernardo, and we're having a nice conversation regarding our upcoming elections.
You look at this election. This is really it's historical in a strange way.
In many ways. I mean, we just rolled out early voting last year, and
there's
so many.
How'd that go? What was the feeling last year?
Look, there's a tone in the office because I'm past my year anniversary a couple days
Congratulations,
ago.
Congratulations,
John.
Baptism by fire is an understatement. The moment I walked in the door along with my counterpart, Jen Fuentes, it seems like the office went up in flames because we had to implement so many new things.
See, the storm was coming.
Well, it was strange because you had the Kavanaugh Clegg recount. That was
and early voting for him at the Board of Elections.
That was wild.
My boss Tom went on record with us saying that this was the toughest election he ever had in his 20 something something year.
Yeah. So a lot of stuff.
You're saying it's my first election. What are you doing to me?
Right.
And then all of a sudden you hit January and we're walking right into a pandemic that didn't know it was going to hit us this hard. And now we're saying this is going to be the toughest election again.
Right.
Another tough one.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because traditionally, is it maybe the word or not the word, presidential elections are of the highest
voter turnout.
Voter turnout, right? So here we sit, John, with you having all these things to get, you know, just a ballot.
We got to check the retrograde, too.
We used to talk about that all the time.
We hope it's not during that time.
Just watching how last year we made the shift to want to make voting experience easier, more efficient, and effective at getting you through the poll site with the implementation of the poll pads was one thing. And then to watch, okay, we just implemented this in early voting to make sure that you have more access to voting. Right.
Yeah, and now pandemic.
So now, but not necessarily the pandemic, but the way you vote. We focused so hard on making sure that your in-person experience was so well last year that now all of a sudden we have to shift focus and say, if you're voting from home, we have to make sure your experience is very well. And that's where the change in focus has come, because we can't take our eye off the ball on actual elections and poll sites. We still have to perform at that level to make sure that each poll site is up and operational. And on top of that, we have to exceed our expectations tenfold with absentees.
It's really interesting because last year I voted early voting because I wanted to see or feel the experience, so to speak, with the iPad. And the thing that I called the Board of Elections about was my signature, right? Because you had to make a signature
with
your finger or a pen, whatever, a stylus or something. And it didn't look anything like my signature. And of course, we had a chat about it. And purely by trying to understand, they have a book, they check, who you are. Did I not have to, or did I have to show ID? I don't even remember.
You don't have to show ID in New York State. Those who do have to show ID, it's a very specific subset of voters who are either first-time individuals who haven't provided us with a DMV or Social Security number prior to their voting, or they happen to have just registered and haven't given that specific information. It's a one-and-done thing. You never show it a second time. If any of our inspectors do ask you for to show ID, you can tell them you don't have to, or call us.
I think
affidavit ballot is that. Do you show ID for that or
affidavit ballot? No, you're still it's filling it out like a voter registration form, stating a reason for why you have to fill that out as to what might have been the cause for you not being in the poll book.
Yeah, so. You do.
I think it changes that, but I would like to see people use their photo ID. Quite frankly, that's me.
It comes around the discussion of the signature is your identification mark. Yes. And I'm going to just take the step out of the commissioner hat and just go under. This is my personal opinion with everything regarding verification. We're in a world today where you need that extra step, and it's known as like two-factor authentication. I mean, if you go and you try and sign into an application on your phone, whether it's your bank account or social media, you're now asked for that additional step beyond your password. And I don't know that we'll ever see anything like this in voting, or maybe it will become so intuitive that like it's very easy to implement that you're going to not just need your signature, but you would need something else to secure your vote. And it's not to disenfranchise anybody by any means.
Right.
Need to know that number one, that 1 + 1 = 2, and that isn't going to change. And with signatures, it's difficult right now because that's where the biggest question, that's where a lot of people are raising questions.
Sure.
And that's where,
can you explain a little bit about the absentee ballot and that there is a signature at the bottom of the ballot?
Correct.
And what happens with their absentee ballot after they mail it in? What does that process look like?
Because everybody has to apply for an absentee, the absentee application itself has a signature box. When we receive your ballot back in traditional years, we would refer your application signature to your ballot signature.
You have to sign it.
Yes.
Yeah, you see, in the back of the envelope, You have to sign the back of the envelope when you Okay, so what the process looks like and complete, you're sitting at a table and you have the ballot open in front of you. You vote for whom you want to vote for. Mm-hmm. It gets folded up to fit into an envelope that's supplied by the Board of Elections. At that time, you have to seal the envelope and sign it where you're sealing it. There's a V. That's on the outside. You sign that envelope.
And yeah, then we have a caller, actually. Good morning, caller.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Good morning, Mr. Quigley. How are you today?
Good. How are you?
Oh, I can't complain. Nobody listens. At least it's not raining.
I think I know that voice. Is that Ed Gatti?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I was in Connecticut yesterday, land of 1,000 tornadoes.
Ooh.
But anyway, what I was calling about, I wanted to add a personal observation to it. It was the age of corona. How could you not answer ID? Everybody's wearing a mask.
Say that again. We couldn't hear you.
I said, in the age of corona, how could you not ask people for IDs when they're voting? Everybody's going to be wearing a mask.
Well, I mean, that's a good question. And unfortunately, I would have to say you got to take that to my higher ups at the state legislature. At the Board of Elections, we're stuck enforcing the law, and the law lately has been changing day to day. Who knows? There could be a executive order tomorrow saying that we would have to check that. But it is something that in today, since our verification method is a signature and not a picture or a photo of a person, and unless you're the inspector who knows everybody in your neighborhood, you won't know every single voter that comes there. So it does make things a bit more challenging.
I will tell you, I can't get into my bank right now because everyone's wearing a mask without showing an ID to a closed door.
Yeah.
And then they got to look at it. You go in a government building, you got to show an ID. You write a check, you have to show an ID. Another personal observation, some of the people are screaming about no voter IDs. My friends in the Democratic Party at the DNC convention, you had to show an ID to get in.
Well, just the fact that the ID is the other authentication method to prove you are who you are, that is that extra step.
Yeah, but to Ed's point, you know, it's really funny. Listen, we could talk about that specific point all day long and how, you know, we try to, you know, use IDs. The fact of the matter is we're becoming more and more in tune to showing our IDs. We hope one day that could happen all the time. But as it relates right now, it's not the law and it's not an executive order, so they have to use what they can as the signature. The interesting part about the signature is, historically, the Board of Elections looks at that signature, and if we're recounting or doing a count or want to compare it to what they call buck card, which is your original signature that you give to the Board of Elections, they don't allow it. They can look at it, but they won't verify if it matches because they're not handwriting specialists. So we have all these little things that have come up to only push toward, in my opinion, the voter ID. But, you know, it is what it is, and I got to tell you, these guys, they work so hard.
Oh, my gosh, they work so hard. I mean,
get it right, and I got to give you a kudos.
I was at the table with, you were there, and clearly John was there with his red pencil.
Right.
And you guys, you do.
And I have to give kudos to the election workers. I sat there in polling places more than once as a watcher, as a voter waiting line, listening to people who got up that morning with their grouchy pants on, and they maintained their cool.
Yeah, Ed, it's really, you know, we're really grateful for the staff at the Board of Elections. Yeah. Well, Ed, I appreciate you giving us a call, and don't be chasing those tornadoes.
It was more like they were chasing me yesterday. Every time I thought I got away from the rain, it found me again.
Hey, Ed, how's Beth doing and the kids?
I'm doing just fine.
Good.
Emily just got her associates from SUNY Dutchess. No, I'm not being disloyal to my own county. that he didn't have here. Yeah. And she's moving on, and next year it'll be New Falls, God help us all.
Wow. It's amazing. I know those kids when they were knee-high, boy. It's crazy. Anyway, great talking to you. I'll talk to you soon.
Yeah.
Thanks for calling in, Ed. Have a great day.
Same to all
the challenges are there.
Challenges are.
But the opportunities to vote
are greater right now, and I think that's fabulous.
Correct. I mean, we just had multiple new pieces of legislation put in place regarding the signature on the absentee. It's very small detail. A lot of people won't even know what we're talking about right now when we're talking about the signature on an absentee. But if you happen to be one of those individuals who vote by absentee or affidavit and you get a letter in the mail a couple weeks after the election saying your vote wasn't counted because of a specific reason, one of those reasons isn't going to be because of the signature now. Because
so you notify people if that happens?
We do.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that.
Oh, yeah.
And now there's this whole cure process where if you're missing a signature on the back of your absentee, we have to notify you and give you an opportunity to cure that, come in and say that, yes, in fact, you were that voter. That cure process we are still defining because it's so new as to how you will be doing that. But we're now going the extra mile for even those that have some question marks to make sure that they're...
So, John, if we could get back to the process, they mail in their absentee ballot. Where does their ballot go from there?
They're filling out that application stating where they want that ballot mailed.
No, after you receive it at the Board of... what does the process really look like on the inside?
When we receive that ballot back at the Board of Elections, we have to stamp them in. And we will stamp them in to prove the time and date that we got that batch in from the post office. And they will be stored safely and securely in our room where we do all the counting as we organize them to be counted by town. Traditionally is how we do it.
Yep.
It's really funny. That process alone, I was asking John actually off air before the show, is do these ballots that are mailed in, are they going to be hand-counted where they physically count each one or put through a machine? And, John, you could answer it now, obviously.
Just to explain the hand-count process, it usually consisted of us sitting there observing every envelope and whether there was a certain party there to represent a candidate on either side of the aisle. They'd look at each envelope itself. If they had questions, they'd raise them then and there. And then afterwards, we would go through an opening process where we would then place the ballots into the center of a table on a pile until we organize them all to preserve anonymity of the voter and not know which ballot went with which envelope.
Right.
And that's very important because a lot of people do question how that happens. At no point do we ever see specific people's votes. And once that pile is created, it's up to two commissioners sitting side by side. One is counting and reading it off so that another set across the table are actually tallying the votes. And that we go through that process time and time again until we complete those.
This is really an inside baseball situation as it relates to the county. But what you're eliminating then, if you do have a close race, right, and you have absentee ballots, you're eliminating the opportunity for those envelopes to be challenged because of a bad date, because of a bad signature. So that part, because you're opening them to count them, that whole process of challenging envelopes for whatever signatures goes away.
That's in close races,
you always have that option to challenge those envelopes.
You do, but how do you know what ballot it is?
Correct, but that's because at that point, if you haven't already made your challenge at that point,
No, you're not following me. So you get the envelopes in. You're going to open them. You're going to put them through a machine.
Oh yeah, John didn't explain the process yet.
Talking about the mail envelope back.
Right. So all these people.
Why would you be challenging the mail envelope when it comes back?
And that's the point, John. You see. What happens is, going back the old way where you just had an absentee ballot, right? They sit in a bag, as you guys call it. And then they're set up and put into town order, right? And then it's up to the commissioners to figure out what town goes first and how they're going to open these ballots. At that moment in time, the candidate is there, right? And if they are represented by a lawyer, they are there. And then they pick a town, and they go envelope by envelope, and you look at it. They stare at it, and they stare at it for a lot of reasons, as you know. and they could what they call set them aside.
Yeah, and you still can.
How?
The exact same process.
Okay, so explain this. So when they come in, coming into the
we're not just opening the envelopes.
Running them through a machine?
We're not just opening the ballots prior to any usual. We're still using ours. That whole same process that you just described
just explain the process,
is still in
maybe.
Place.
Wow.
That whole process that you just described is still in place. The only thing that changes that, well, is going to change this year due to the fact that we have what is known as a central counter, is that rather than the function of two commissioners sitting side by side to count,
tally.
We're going to, those two individuals are going to be sitting in front of a scanner
This is going to take forever for you guys.
Actually, it won't. It will be a lot easier because what it will do is expedite the counting process.
Break it down. So the ballots come back into the Board of Elections after you send it in.
Yep.
From there, what happens, John?
Go into a bag.
No. No. Our ballots are...
Then you get stamped that they're
stamped
received.
That stamp is the approval that it has made it in prior to a
specific deadline.
The deadline.
Yep.
Any ballot received after the deadline, not only is the ballot envelope stamped, but the actual envelope in which it was mailed, With the postmark showing the identification that it was late, stays with that ballot envelope. It is usually stapled together as proof to make sure that if that ballot itself was to come into question to be counted,
you could see the deadline.
It is automatically set aside not to be counted.
Are challenged. Those are the ones that
ones who are accepted. So made it there on time.
And let's finish through the process. So after the ones that have made it through there on time, they're sorted based on how we determine we're going to count. They're stored in a back room that only two people have access to primarily. And at the time that we are ready to count, meaning we have completed making sure that those who voted in person are removed from the absentee.
Right, that's the step.
There's a cure process before the count process.
Right.
That has to take place where we make sure that those absentees are in fact the number to be counted by the Board of Elections.
And we have another caller. Good morning, caller.
Good morning.
Good morning, George.
How's it going up there, everybody?
It's a great day.
Yeah, it's a beautiful day, especially after all the heavy thunderstorms we had yesterday.
Yeah, it's always a great day in Ulster County.
Yes. Question, on the outside envelope, down where the barcode is on the back, is there any way to get rid of that R and D, which tells you who the person is maybe voting for?
So you're referring to the like the party label that is actually only on the oath envelope itself when it's on the sticker. That happens in primaries, specifically for sorting reasons, and for purpose of going through the mail process, at no point when a ballot goes through the mail is a mailman or anybody independently able to tell your party affiliation.
Oh, the general election.
Yeah, because there was an email going around that I saw from somebody who was saying, showing their R&D and to where a postal worker, if they knew how to read the back of the envelope with the barcode and stuff, with some of them do.
So this it's a county by county decision on what information is presented on the envelopes. For in Ulster County specifically, I can tell you that mail envelope, at no point does a postal man have the ability to see your party affiliation.
Okay, good. Yeah, because I used to work for the post office down in Newburgh when it was a big processing center when they had 500 people, which now there's only about 25. Because the mail down there got transferred up to Albany. And I was just wondering if anybody could read the outside envelopes ahead of time. But, guys do a great job.
Thank you. I've
been working for you guys for the past number of years.
Thank you so much.
But with the COVID this past year and stuff, and being at the age where you're most susceptible for
We talked about this earlier.
I decided not to be there.
Well, I appreciate the fact that you worked for us in previous years, and maybe not this year, but hopefully next year we can see if we can get you back.
Oh, yeah. Well, hey, if the COVID's out of here, I'll be back.
That's it.
Otherwise, and I know when people talk about people coming in the polls in the grouchy mood and stuff, but you do get some real grouchy people there.
But we kill them with kindness. But, that's what we always say.
Well, we try to.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, George.
A lot of people come in a good mood. Good morning. How are you doing? They know your name and everything else, especially if you're from the town. And it's like a get-together session. But you guys do a great job. You have a tough job. And especially with this past election, with the recounts, and also now this year is going to be really tough with all the absentee ballots and everything. But I'm glad the state is going with the fact where you have to request one.
Thank you.
And not just go by a mailing list and mailing them out to everybody that's on their list, whether they're alive, dead, moved, or whatever. So
yep. We
need to keep the integrity in the system, and I would like to see ID being taken at the polls at some point because that is important nowadays.
I agree.
Thank you, people, very much for what you do. Keep up the good work, and good luck this year. I hope everything goes smoothly and quickly.
Thank you for calling in. People.
Thank you, George. Have a great day.
Bye-bye. No, it's amazing how there's a good example. He was a poll watcher. You know, he's a voter, obviously, postal worker. He has seen the system.
We have another caller. Good morning, caller. Caller, good morning. Yeah.
Good morning. Thank you for all the wonderful work you do. I mean, it is amazing to watch you in action and to, when you go to the polling places. Question I have is, will we be able to see in advance what the ballots are? Like, will they be posted in the newspaper? Or are they posted on the internet?
Excellent question.
So we're still in the early stages, and a lot of people think, like, the ballot's already made because we've had this discussion. I mean, I think it was just yesterday the RNC made their official nomination.
Correct, they did.
This process, designing and creating the ballot, will take place until about the middle of September. Hopefully September 10th or so, we'll have finalized the actual ballot itself that you'll be able to vote on. So I would say when we're ready towards the end of September, early October, our ballots will be posted on our website, voteulster.com. They are specific by whether poll site or however we break them down, whether it's absentee voting or for actual in-person voting, based on the number of people who are on the ballot. We still do have some local races this year. So your ballots will be made available. They will just probably be mid to late September and early October that they will finally make their way to our website for your viewing. We will try and share that the best we can with as many other resources that request to see those so that they can share them with people like you.
And also, being a civilian in the process, there are moments in time where I actually went to the Board of Election and requested a sample ballot.
Yes. And whenever you go into a poll site, we have what is known as an informational table where we put out sample ballots for you to view prior to actually going to get your ballot. Ironically, sometimes you'll get that person who walks in, grabs that sample ballot, thinking it's their ballot, start filling it out. But we do everything we can to make sure the ballot's available to you prior to you actually getting yours to vote on.
Yeah. Oh, thank you, and God bless you for all you do.
Thank you.
One of the most important things that enable the citizen to have a voice. So keep up the great work.
Thank you for calling in.
Great. Thank you for calling.
Welcome.
It's
really true.
It's a great show today. I got to tell you, put a great show together. Thank you. You really did.
Invite some of my friends. You know, that's there how it all works out. What's interesting, when I ran my first race, the whole family went to the polling place. Back then, I think my grandmother was about 87, my 80-year-old mother-in-law. My dad is like, he's just 70. But, as a candidate on the ballot, you would have thought they all knew how to fill out the ballot.
They don't.
Oh, my gosh. My mother-in-law checked my name off of every single spot she saw on the ballot.
Which made it no good.
My dad put like X's instead of filling out this. Yeah. And I'm not quite sure what happened with my grandmother, but she required assistance. And it was like the longest process. I had to wait outside for a really long time.
It's really kind of cool when you think about that. They get excited.
They get really, really excited. Yeah. But that actually was, my grandmother refused to go to the poll again after that. She said she just would prefer to do it. It became a little bit too overwhelming for her.
You know, it's really funny. My mom, although passed a couple years now ago at 96, she requested a permanent absentee ballot probably at the age of 88 or 90.
Yeah.
And let me tell you, even up till then, where she would not show it to anybody. She would sit there and just play with it and fiddle with it. And I said, Mike, you want me to help you fill it out? And she was like, nope. Don't. I said, do you understand you got to fill in the things? But it was great. But thanks again for putting together such a great, you know,
yeah,
show.
Thank
John,
you, John.
Thanks.
Yeah,
I hope you hang out for the next segment, John.
I'm hanging out because I got to be in the office. It's
yeah, he's
right
got work
corner,
to do, so he's going to hang out. Okay, well, we're heading into the top of the hour again. And Dan, we'll see you on the other side.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM. And also online at mykcr.org.
Central Hudson reminds you that summer thunderstorms can strike with strong, gusty winds, knocking down trees and power lines. If you see a downed power line, call 911 immediately to report it. Power lines can carry an electric current strong enough to cause injury or death. Stay at least 30 feet away from a fallen line. Don't try to move it or anything that has come in contact with it. And never drive over a power line. Remember, your safety matters.
Hey, hon, what you doing with your phone?
Do flowers have best friends?
I don't know.
Hey, look.
Whoa.
Some answers can only be found in nature. Discover the unsearchable. Visit discovertheforest.org to find a trail near you. Brought to you by the United States Forest Service and the Ad Council.
We are Lions. We bring hope where it's needed. Support causes that matter. Change lives. Change communities. Change the world. Visit lionsclubs.org to learn more.
Hi, this is Deirdre Mance from Spring Lake Fire Department. I support Kingston Community Radio, and you should too.
Thank you for being with us at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, WGHQ, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. It's Friday, August 28th, 64 degrees here in uptown Kingston. And don't forget, KCR's Radiothon continues today to keep the morning show on the air. Help us reach our goal of $12,000 by calling 331-1004 to make your pledge or send a check to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. Again, you're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, and 64 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. And let's get back to the on-air studio with Heidi Haynes and Len Bernardo and John Quigley. Welcome back.
Yes, welcome back, and it is birthday time, and right after our birthdays, we have a very special guest who's waiting, but first we're going to have a little birthday party here.
There we are.
So we're going to start off for birthdays for today, Friday, August 28th, and we're wishing a very happy birthday to Dot Elliott from your friends at the Wellness and Healthy Lifestyle Club. Happy birthday, Dot.
And August 28th, happy birthday to Lori Biamonte from your friends at the Hurley Pearlers.
Continuing with August 28th, happy birthday, Barbara Kinn from your friends at Hurley Pearlers.
And we also have a very special happy birthday to Priscilla Amadeo from one of your old church friends, Diane. And moving on to the winner of the Boyce Dairy Milk House, birthday winner of a famous cow pie. For
and who is it, Heidi?
Lori Biamonte.
Hey, Lori, congratulations.
Congratulations and happy birthday. Moving on to Saturday, August 29th, we have a very special happy 80th birthday to Joe Shrowang from your friends and family, your wife, Muffy, children, and grandchildren.
Shrowang.
Yeah, and happy birthday to Joe. And guess what? Joe happens to be the winner of the famous Boyce Brothers famous cow pie. Enjoy that, Joe. And we have actually no birthdays on Sunday, but I'm sure it's somebody's birthday
there
on
you
Sunday
go.
Out there. So if you're celebrating a birthday, Friday, Saturday, or Sunday, we want to wish
birthday.
You a very happy birthday. And I'm going to be going over to Boyce Brothers later this afternoon.
Are you really?
Yeah, I have to pick up a nice cake for Lydia for tomorrow. She's going to be celebrating her confirmation.
Oh, isn't that great?
Yeah, yeah. So it's a good celebration. So happy birthday, everyone. And we're going to go ahead and pick up on to our caller. Our next guest Actually, why don't you go ahead and do the...
Yeah, let me introduce a gentleman that I've known for a long time, Frank McKay. He is the chairman of the New York State Independence Party. Frank is also a first-place winner of the Presset Club Award of Long Island. So Frank is really a radio person, and we're not.
So much. Frank,
are you there?
Forgive us.
I want to thank you for coming on, and we haven't even talked about your special announcement yet today. But
very special announcement.
Well, listen, Heidi, John, and Len, I want to thank you for having me. And yes, again, happy birthday to everyone you just mentioned there. And by the way, you say you guys aren't radio people. You sound pretty damn good to me. We're here to announce, I'm here to announce, that the Independence Party has endorsed a presidential candidate. And no, it's not one of the major party candidates. It's along the lines that we feel comfortable with. And his name is Brock Pierce. He's running with a wonderful woman named Calla Ballard.
Yep.
And Calla Ballard is from Philadelphia, and she is wonderful. She's got a law enforcement background. She's from the African-American community, but she gets it. I think she's a perfect balance for Brock. And Brock is a Bitcoin billionaire. He is someone who's made a tremendous amount of money in the private sector. He's certainly not a politician, nor is Caller. And I think that's a refreshing change from where we usually are. And I think he's sure a departure from anything we're used to having.
A 39-year-old guy, he is just dynamic. Frank was nice enough to invite me down to Manhattan on Tuesday for the initial announcement. And I got a chance to speak to him for a couple of minutes, really not a long time, because it was such a busy day. But solid guy. Frank, and I have to commend you again, you and Tom, for going out and, you know, getting out in front of this and getting a great candidate for us on the Independence Party line.
Presidential candidate.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, quite frankly, there were different candidates, and I don't want to disparage anyone, but there are other people out there that are running for president, as there is every 4 years, and we scour the earth, the country, more specifically, for those individuals. And whoever he or she may be, we meet with them, and we talk with them, and we try to see if they're a fit. And they're usually not. It's usually, you know, an individual is just kind of running for the heck of running. Brock Pierce means it. He is not just running this year. And again, to say he's a long shot this year is an understatement. We know that. This isn't about this year. This isn't the next president of the United States. But we do believe he's a future president of the United States. And it's a foundational run for 4 years from now. And these two are getting their feet wet. And I mean politically getting their feet wet. As far as being able to run the country, they're ready right now to do that. These two individuals will get some attention. One quick point, you know, I know some folks were saying, well, you're going to peel votes from Biden, or you're going to, you know, do something like that. But look, in New York State, because of how it is, it's almost a one-party system. Biden's going to win New York State. I mean, let's face it. I mean, he's not going to come out of the city without winning with New York State. Brock Pierce is not competing with Joe Biden or Donald Trump for those same votes. These are people that are going to vote for someone who most likely is not 70 years old. He's 39 years old. He's closer to being 18 than he is to 70. Right. And by no means are we disparaging, you know, this on age. There's no question about it. A lot of wisdom comes with age. Brock Pierce is different. He's got energy. He has he's highly intelligent. I mean, beyond. And again, he's made himself a billionaire, and he's given away billions of dollars while he's at it. He's a former child star. He was in the Mighty Ducks. He was the young Emilio Estevez, and that he had a role, the starring role in First Kid, and a lot of different roles. He decided at the top of his career, when he was being offered, started to get offered seven digits and making a tremendous impact, as a child actor, he decided he didn't want to do it any longer, and he got out, and he wanted to be an entrepreneur, and this new thing called the internet intrigued him, and he said, you know what, this is going to be a big deal, I'm on top of this, and at a very young age, 16, 17, he dove into it, and he, again, he made himself a billionaire.
Yep. He lives in Puerto Rico, and he did a lot of foundational work during the hurricanes and after the hurricanes, and he's very proud of that. He's worked very hard in helping bring farmers back and folks like that. And interesting, because one of the things that he talks about, one of his platform pieces, you can see it going online on YouTube to see a lot of his little vignettes, but he talks about jobs and how he helped the folks and farmers in Puerto Rico get back on their feet, which was really an amazing little talk I had with him. You know, Frank, yeah. I'm sure you had the same talk with the guy.
Frank, you mentioned how this might not be the year, but the foundational year that he's putting forward to consider maybe 4 years from now or be able to make that actual run, even if this is still him putting his platform out there. Could you potentially compare him, not ideologically, but to somebody like Andrew Yang, who was early on in the scene, made his platform known, and then 4 years from now, he's at the stage and they're running with the potential to make that next step?
I think people can certainly make that comparison. I won't. You know, I think they're two different individuals.
100%.
No question they have different skills and different personalities, but certainly people could draw that comparison if they would like. The difference is that Andrew Yang was running in the Democratic primary.
Correct.
To try to get that nomination. Brock Pierce is running as an independent. If the Democrats and the Republicans gave him on the silver platter a nomination, he wouldn't take it. He couldn't take it. He's too individualistic to fit into any cookie cutter mode. And let's face it, if you're a Republican, there is a set amount of things that you're expected to be and stances that you're about to take. And same thing with Democrats. Obviously, we know what the Democratic Party has in store for their candidates and what the candidate is expected to talk about. The difference between Brock and Caller, that and big difference, and I know both Joe Biden and I know Donald Trump very well, is when you hear them speak about their candidacy or their vision for the country, it's their vision for the country. People like myself and Len and Heidi and other folks in the Independence Party, we're not dictating to them what they can say or what they can't say, what they should feel about a certain issue. We're giving them a platform. And that's the difference between the Independence Party and the two major parties.
Right.
We've been criticized in the past for not having a strong stance on social issues. It defeats the purpose. What they're suggesting we should have, and again, mainstream media, certainly the left has killed us over the years over that. But the point of our party is to create a third major party in this country that takes no stance on social issues and that won't force feed their candidates how they should believe and how they should speak. What we want is we want an honest dialogue between American voters and, in our case, the New York voters and Brock Pierce and Carla Ballard. If we were interfering with that and we were a major party, you wouldn't know quite what was coming out of Brock's mouth as his own words. Here, everything Brock says is his own.
Right.
You know, it's funny because probably many people hearing his name for the first time. I've actually followed Brock Pierce for a while now due to his involvement in his career with both Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies as well as his philanthropy work and everything else. So, I mean, the fact that he's choosing to be politically involved, you've just changed his trajectory tremendously should he actually choose to continue to pursue this as best as he can. Because when he puts his mind to something, it's very interesting to watch.
So we have a good candidate.
It's just very interesting to watch when you have individuals who set their mind to something and
Absolutely.
They have that work ethic.
You know, Frank, we're sitting here with John Quigley, who was a Republican, but a young man. And earlier, I said we had the surprise guest and you, and we were going to make this announcement today. and you made it now, he perked up a little bit because it's something, someone that he could relate to. Now, we're not saying he's going to vote for the guy. I'm just going to say, but he perked up and listened. And that's what we need. We need people to perk up and listen. I have to tell you, it's just fun and really happy. Happiness is the word. To see someone youthful, as you said earlier, just get the word out, his word out. And I have to tell you, I spent more time with Carla than I did with Brock. And she really is a brilliant lady. Just a down to earth. She comes from Philly, just a great person. And you know, Heidi, when Frank was talking, he was describing you.
Yeah, I was thinking that very much.
He really was.
And I'm like, this is why I'm here.
Right.
And a lot of people affiliate my party involvement with my relationship with you. But the fact of the matter is I was a member of the Independence Party long before I met you.
Right,
you
were. Before you knew you were.
she knew? Right.
Yeah, that too.
But no, Frank, and Heidi's success is because of what you said, specifically, doing the people's work, understanding, listening, and it's all that.
Being stuffed into a silo.
Right.
And for those listening, if you're not too aware or too familiar with Heidi, she is also a county legislator who serves her district extremely well, regardless of party affiliation.
Yep.
And, I mean, I know my label might be a Republican, and I might be in the Board of Elections, but I'm in the elections business to make sure quality candidates run, because this is what our democracy depends on. And I think you see that in the way some of our leadership chooses to get these candidates out there.
Yeah. You know, Frank, one of our goals here, I did contact Rachel out in California about seeing if we can get Brock and Carla on the show. And maybe we'll bring that up to Lawrence at some point, and you as well, at the same time, because I think just let the people hear them. It's very important for our party, the Independence Party, to let people know what our voice is, and how we're trying to do our job every day, and that's where we are right now. And then if we could bring votes to him and make him realize that he has a bright future here, it's important to have people get involved in these trying times, and any time, I guess, in the United States of America.
Yeah, I think you guys are all right on. I mean, first of all, let me just say this. Heidi Haynes is the poster child, the poster person for what we want in a candidate. We want somebody who's their own individual, who's going to go out and care about what's happening in their community and do their own thing. We've never said to Heidi, hey, Heidi, we wish you would be a little more like this, or we wish you'd be a little more.
That wouldn't work anyway.
Right. Yep. She'll tell us to jump in the lake, first of all. But second of all, I mean, we want individuals. Second of all, addressing Carla, Carla Ballard, I said she has a law enforcement background. She's an entrepreneur. She is a self-made person. She has made a tremendous amount of wealth for herself. She has run businesses. The two of these people could run the country, either one of them, interchangeably. But Brock Pierce and Carla Ballard are just a talented team. Next, I want to address what John said. I appreciate your knowledge of Bitcoin and cryptocurrency and where Brock fits in there. But the one point that you made, Landon, you said, well, he's not going to vote for him. Gee, here's the thing. We're not trying to convince people that are Republicans to vote for Brock, or we're not trying to convince people that are Democrats to vote against Biden. The people that are solid with their candidate, solid with their party affiliation, we know where they're going.
Right.
You know, most likely we know where they're going, and that's fine. We're not trying to go there. I've written 8 books, but I mean, my main book has over 100,000 downloads on it, and, between sales and downloads, free downloads and everything. But it's called What About the Rest of Us? And that's what we address. A guy like Brock Pierce is for people that don't identify themselves with it solidly with a major party. What about the rest of us? Don't we deserve a party? Don't we deserve a candidate? And Brock Pierce and Carla Ballard are those two individuals. I just want to make one more point. Brock Pierce is the first resident of Puerto Rico ever to run for the presidency of the United States. And I say that because there are a lot of residents of Puerto Rico, former residents or descendants of residents here in New York State that are Puerto Rican descent and folks that are there. I think they could look to Brock Pierce as someone who lives on the island. That is going to be good.
I agree.
A vote for Brock Pierce is great. You know, and again, whether he's elected or he's not elected, a vote for Brock Pierce brings attention to that island. And I think it's very important for the folks. And I think it's very important for me as the leader of the Independence Party to reach out to those voters. And we will be doing that.
I agree. You know, it's really funny. I was talking to Terry last night, and I said, you know, it would be interesting to find out how many folks in New York City, state, have relatives in Puerto Rico, and do a mailing from those relatives in Puerto Rico to the ones in New York, saying, get out there and vote for them.
Great idea.
You know, so it's, you know, it's things like that that bring awareness to his entrepreneurial feeling of what he did in Puerto Rico, and let people feel what kind of guy he really is, and what kind of independent spirit he really is. No, it's going to be an interesting time, that's for sure. Of course, I gave a mask to Heidi, Frank, that I had the extra one.
Thank you. Well, hey, listen, it's so important to keep our eye on the prize, and for us, it's the voters of New York State, and we want to empower them, and certainly the independent voters of New York State, and specifically the independent party voters, and I think by bringing forward Brock Pierce and Carla Ballard on the on the state ticket is just a wonderful. I think they're going to help the down ticket for sure. I think we're going to get a tremendous amount of votes. And by the way, I mean our alternative was almost doing no one.
Right.
And, you know, we weren't comfortable with some of the other names that were out there. You know, last time we endorsed Gary Johnson and again we got 119,000 votes. With Gary Johnson, and he got 60,000 votes on the Libertarian Party.
We right.
split it. It's 180,000 votes, and he did nothing. You know,
right.
he didn't do any campaigning in New York, virtually nothing. He spent no money. We spent no money, and we just kind of put it out there, and Gary Johnson was an alternative to the two major party candidates. Here, this is much different. Brock is engaging in New York, we're engaging in New York, and we're going to run a real campaign here as an independent party, and the Independence Party is going to put forward a real effort this time. I think we're going to do a tremendous amount. We're going to have a tremendous amount of impact, and we're going to get a tremendous amount of votes on this particular race.
And we really do have a good slate of candidates on the Independence line, up and down the ticket. From Congressman Anthony Delgado right through the Rich Amador, the Martucci's. So we have some good solid folks on the line that are going to help carry too for Brock and with Brock.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And the area that you guys are from has become my second home. As Heidi knows, I have a my aunt's house where we're up there, and we're working on settling an estate, and she's in Hurley. I spent summers as a child in Hurley, and I actually lived in Cottage Hill.
I lived
in Cottage Hill for about a year, and I went to school at Rondout Valley High School.
Funny.
How about that?
He lived right around. He lived right around the corner from my house. Small world. He went to my high school.
Lucas Avenue.
Yep.
I met Frank's brother unfortunately, his aunt's memorial dinner, and we were chatting, and he had stories about him and Frank running around Ulster County having a good time with music. How many people that they met through music. Frank's background, his brother's background, promoting music, getting involved in music, and which is a phenomenal story on its own. They had a magazine. They had all sorts of stuff going on. But, Frank was, he was the running around Ulster County,
town doing a lot of stuff.
Yep, town of Rosendale, doing the music scene.
It's a wonderful area. I mean, Ulster County is just wonderful. So many people. I had someone on yesterday. William Sadler. He was promoting his movie, Bill and Ted face-off, you know, Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure. But he's someone who's really built an incredible career, and he was talking about the Hudson Valley. He was talking very affectionately about it. I said, I know the Hudson Valley, you know, and
yep.
I think he's closer to Poughkeepsie than you guys. He's more like Dutchess County, but still, so many people find a home up there, and especially now with coronavirus. I
think yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's exploding.
Are realizing it's a great lifestyle choice.
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, Frank, I want to thank you so much for coming on this morning and the short notice that we asked you. We appreciate everything you've done for the party, and we're going to keep plugging away and pushing out candidates.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah, Frank.
We'd love to have Brock and Paula on one of these days, and as we say, Brock the vote.
Rock the vote. That's right.
I said that without even knowing.
Maybe we could talk to Lawrence about getting them on. When you have
absolutely.
A show, you know, that'd be great. But yeah, Brock the Vote is the name of the game.
Thanks again,
John,
Frank.
Heidi and Glenn, thank you very much for having me.
Absolutely.
Oh, anytime. Thank you.
Have a great weekend.
You too.
Oh, great. Ciao.
He was great. He was really, Frank's a great guy. You know, he's got a tough job. They do, and we all do. As you know, I get, I always joke with Heidi and I joke with Frank that, you know, we endorse candidates, but we're able to piss off 50% of the people 100% of the time because we just can't endorse everyone, you see. We are looking to have candidates. And Heidi, I mean, really, the great story about Heidi is I was a commissioner in Accord.
Fire district.
And Heidi
where
was,
I was just there minding my business,
minding
doing
her
my
business,
job, my little nice job at
and
the
I
firehouse.
And I said to Heidi, I says, Heidi, what are you registered? And she looked at me and said, I don't know. I'm not political.
I'm not political.
Right. And so, of course, what do I do is I go to the voter rolls, John.
A couple days later, he comes back.
And
excited.
I said, Heidi, I'm a little excited. I said, Heidi, look, you're an Independence Party member. And she goes, really? I says, yeah, look, there's your name. She goes, wow. I said, you're in my party. Welcome to it.
I was like, oh, God.
That was a lot of years ago, huh?
That was 2011.
Yeah.
How you originally met Len.
Yeah. Len would come into the firehouse.
She hated me. She did.
I did. In the beginning, for a little bit, I didn't enjoy Len's presence that much. And because he would come in with like all of this like crazy energy, and I needed to do my job. And Len is, you know, if you know Len, it's pacing back and forth with his cell phone and a lot of political talk that I totally had no, you know, interest in at all. I just wanted to be there doing my job. And from there, you know, we became great friends. And, you know, I admitted to him that I had called him a bad name behind his back. I said,
more than once.
When I first met you, I really thought you were, you know, a real big jerk.
Yeah.
I just have to really let you know that.
Let's be clear on that. A pompous jerk, if I remember correctly.
It was a pompous A word. And then I said, so I just really feel the need that I have to tell you that I called you that, and I even called you that to other people. And Len replied by saying, yeah, I already heard.
I said,
I've changed my mind now, though.
My experience was a bit younger when I first met you. Man, we were riding around Ulster County in 2008, putting up lawn signs that said Bernardo and Quigley.
Yeah. Listen, you know, a lot of things brought us here today. A lot of things brought you to your job.
Yeah.
A lot of efforts brought, obviously, your success to you. And that only is a testament to both of you.
Yeah.
You know, it's only people like myself who could, you know, kind of push someone forward.
Yeah, you know, and it's been said before, like I said, you know, I thank you for bringing me to the table. But after that, you know, it's really about proving
on yourself.
On
your own. I always say to Heidi, and Frank said it today, and I'm so happy he said it, because I always say to you, Heidi, I always say, do what you think is right. I never ask you for a vote. I never tell you how to vote. I never get involved with your legislative business. I ask questions about it. You know, but quite frankly, you need to do it for yourself. That's the Independence Party way. And Frank said it today.
Yeah, and I really do appreciate that. But I have to say, with that comes difficulty as well.
Sure it
does. Because I don't conform. And there's not a a silo that I fit in.
You don't.
And it forces me, because when you're on one side of the aisle or the other, whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, there's a certain set of ideologies that you conform to, and I'm in the middle. Sometimes in the middle, you could be roadkill if you don't.
Know, it's really,
it really forces me to take a strong look at where do my values lie.
You know, it's really interesting. Comes up. When you have what the condition we're in right now is very, very difficult. We're in a very, binary system with the two major parties, and it's very polarizing, you see. And having the third party in the Independence Party really depolarizes, and that's what we're trying to accomplish, and that's what you've done. Thank you so much. Sorry I'm talking too long.
Yep, we'll be right back. Okay, let's take a little bit of a bottom of the hour break, and we'll be back in about 2 or 3 minutes. And thank you so, so much, Heidi Haynes, John Quigley, Len Bernardo, and thank you, our guest, Frank McKay, for calling in today. It's now at the bottom of the hour, and you're with us on Kingston Community Radio, KCR, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, the home of Kingston Community Radio. And it's Friday, August 28th. 64 degrees here now in uptown Kingston. And don't forget, KCR's Radiothon continues today to help keep the morning show on the air. Help us reach our goal of $12,000 by calling 331-1004 or send a check to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. The Radiothon will continue till we hit our goal. Today, sun and clouds mixed, a high of 83. Tonight, 70% chance of rain showers early, developing into a steady rain overnight, low around 65. Saturday, 80% chance of showers and thunderstorms with a high of 78. And Saturday night, 60% chance of scattered thunderstorms during the evening, becoming clear overnight, bringing us to a very mostly sunny Sunday, a high of 77. And Sunday night, mostly clear sky, low 52. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
The Home Energy Assistance Program, known as HEAP, provides both regular and emergency financial grants to eligible households to help pay utility bills. These benefits have been extended through August 31st. The HEAP Cooling Assistance benefit is now open too. Find out if you are eligible by contacting your County Department of Social Services or by visiting the Payment Assistance section of Central Hudson's website, centralhudson.com.
Is that a faucet running?
That's not a faucet. That's a river rushing through the forest.
Forest rivers provide over 100 million people with clean water to drink.
What? I can't hear you because of the vacuum.
That's not a vacuum. That's the trees in the forest cleaning up the air we breathe.
I didn't know the trees were so amazing.
Yep, and the forest gives us shade, trees to climb.
That's awesome. Let's go explore some more.
Visit the forest today and enjoy all it does just for you. To learn more about the forest and find one near you, go to discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Hi, I'm Paula Strang, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
Thank you for being with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, WGHQ, 920 AM, 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. KCR is talk radio, and we thank all the callers that called in today so far, 331-9255. And let's head into our last half hour of today's Heidi Haynes and Friends. Welcome back.
Thanks, Dan. Kind of hard to describe our show, so Heidi and Friends. Okay.
That's good.
Before we get moving on in our last half hour, I just want to talk about some upcoming events. I noticed on the Raising Your Awareness About Narcotics, Ryan's page, actually, it's the Kelders. They're going to have an Overdose Awareness Day community vigil, and it's a time to remember and a time to act. On Monday, August 31st, going to be a gathering at Academy Green Park at 4 p.m., and they're going to have a peaceful We will act by walking up to the Ulster County office building to raise awareness of the importance of detox mental health care in Ulster County. And that's by the Ryan organization. And they've done so much with raising awareness and removing the stigma. And so I just wanted to promote their nice community vigil, their walk from Academy Green Park, kicking off at 4 p.m. And it says, please remember to wear a mask and maintain your social distancing. They're going to walk from Academy Green Park up to the Ulster County building, which is a nice short walk to raise awareness. You know, we've lost the detox and mental health services here in Ulster County. They had Assemblymember Cahill on, I don't remember what day, but it was just this week, and he spoke to that. And, you know, there's people here in the county who are working hard trying to get answers. A lot of it's being, you know, said that it's due to the pandemic and the moving everything out because of COVID.
Well, you know something, Heidi, it's really amazing. You know, Danny Savona, very involved in the program. They used to do the run. The fact of the matter is that's a pandemic onto its own. And, you know, the COVID thing has really gotten in the way of so much. And so much money has been spent with this COVID. And need, you know, there are a lot of people who need the unemployment money, who need all this stuff. But
we were at a deficit with the detox before.
Isn't that interesting?
You know, and John, you can speak to this through the work we did through the senator's office. There was always a need for people looking for a bed for detox, looking for help for services. And, you know, with your relationship with the villa,
I know,
you know, we had a major issue before, and this has just been,
it's making
it
a lot harder.
I know that our county executive is trying to do what he can do. And but nonetheless, it's, to take these services out when they're greatly needed. Yeah. You know, we have to see about what we can do to be bringing that back here to our hospital,
at least
restoring it to the levels that they had before.
Yep.
And you have all these nonprofits and these groups out there, not just Ryan, but everybody who are fighting not just against government funding that they're not going to be able to get anymore, but against private donations and their fundraisers
money,
that they can't have right now.
Sure.
Yeah.
You see people who traditionally, fundraisers plan for the spring. They're rescheduling for October. They're all virtual. This is the time where we are going to be challenged extremely hard on how much we participate when it comes to voicing our concern for such things as,
you know, you,
Ryan.
It becomes a situation that years and years ago, I worked, when I lived in Manhattan, I had my business in Manhattan. I used to get up every morning at 5 o'clock and go serve breakfast at the Lambs Theater. And I lived downtown. And you get involved in things sometimes, but it's time to, you know, put on those boots again, strap them up, and just find a place to give out a, you know, welcome hand, because that's where we are again. You know, I'm talking about, you know, the 80s when things were a little rough around the edges in the city. As they are now.
I was going to say, whew.
Yeah. So, you know, and whether it be, you know, Ulster County, Sullivan County, Dutchess County, Green, there's always a place to, you know, give that helping hand. And I think now more than ever, we have to take that second look. And I know I am going to. I'm just getting through some stuff right now, reconstructing or finishing a home. But the long and the short of it is that we all need to do that extra little bit right here at the station. You know, it's important. It's, you know, it's raising money for keeping this going.
We're halfway there, almost. We don't want to be living on a prayer.
No, but it's always those little things that really make the difference, Heidi. And I have to tell you, thank you.
No, we've had a lot of people really, you know, contribute. Project Resilience has been really great for our county, and you know, in working for the senator, I speak to people, you know, throughout many different counties, and we're lucky that we've had Project Resilience, and that's been that's a program that's been off of you know, donations, runoff of donations, and we're very lucky here in the county. But you're absolutely right, we can't drop the ball now, and we got to keep pushing forward.
We can't. We do have
now
to push
in a time
forward
where not everybody has that money to give.
Exactly.
It's your time that you can give. Your time is that much more valuable.
This is not a plug for the Martucci guy at all. This is a plug for his foundation, the good they've been doing in the district. They've done a lot of food buying and giving out. And, you know, he's got this bus he's running around with that they do food drops. It's really...
We had people in need before the pandemic.
We did.
You saw it when we used to go over to People's Place for the, you know...
Right.
Every Tuesday, that line
Tuesday,
outside.
The fresh farmers
market. So you can only, you know, even now, it's probably tougher for a line out. But long and the short of it is it's... we need to keep moving forward. Now, back to your events. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay. No.
I took it a different way, I guess.
And on a lighter note, this weekend, Saturday, we actually have the Phoenicia International Festival of the Voice at Tech City.
Isn't that great?
Yeah. So you can go online, I think, to find tickets for that. And Tech City, you know, the county's been doing some good stuff over there.
You know, I hadn't spoke to John Milgram a little bit, but I have to say, I didn't realize he was an opera fan, I guess. But but I really do want to thank Pat for doing what they did out there. You know, there's a guy, right? You know, talk about baptism by fire.
Oh.
Man.
Yeah.
So, I mean, here he is in a running deficit. The poor guy, he's all over the place. But he's got some great people around him, and John being one of them.
Yeah.
And it's really...
I like to call it Cars Under the Stars.
Cars Under the Stars.
You know, they'll be resuming back to, after this event, their drive-in movie theater, which has been very successful.
It's really fabulous.
You know, and it's a great thing to do for our community.
No, it is. It is. You know, and it's funny because, you know, I worry about Juan, and our sheriff and you know, with the budget looks like for him. And I'm always saying, you know, Pat's a reasonable guy. They're reasonable people. They'll work this out. And, you know, they're under a lot, everybody's under a lot of pressure. Everybody's trying to make sure these guidances say you're on a commission,
right now.
So all this stuff that, you know, the pressures, more pressures that you're on, the extra meetings that you go to, you just have at the end of the day that everybody has that good mind and smart mind to make sure we can maintain the services for our community in a positive way. And as funny as it sounds, these things they do with the movies and the opera, it's all positive. It keeps people up. It keeps people engaged. It keeps people happy. And I think we need to be more happy. I mean, you know.
Well, we always do have to, you know, especially over in a town Ulster there, we got to bring a little bit of a ray of sunshine.
Yeah. Yeah.
No fun intended.
No, we're just joking. it's good. I tell you, Heidi, I want to thank you again for having me on with you. And it's fun to be with you to do this.
Yeah, especially because we haven't seen each other that often.
No.
I think I've seen you once during the pandemic.
Right.
We haven't spoken much. It's been difficult.
It has been. Like last year, without the pandemic, you know, you were visiting with us every other weekend.
All over.
Right.
Yeah.
You know?
We were all over and events. And so it's been different. I spend a lot of time in my yard, clearly, between the fact that I've now become a praying mantis whisperer.
Yeah, I see that. Where'd you find that little guy?
Everywhere I look. So I don't know. Clearly.
So tell me how that praying mantis eats the wasp like an ice cream cone?
Rip the head off.
No.
I swear. It holds it. And it does it with everyone. It holds it by the head. And it never eats the stinger. Like this must be like the bottom of the cone. But I watch her all day long. I visit her every day. Her name is Pretty. She's right in my holly bush. So when I'm sitting on my rocking chair, she's there. Every morning I check.
That's
she
so
starts
great.
Eating around 11 because that's when it heats up and the bugs come. But I did find the special needs one. Did you see that one?
Yeah, with the no arms or something.
It was horrible. Yeah. My heart was so broken.
Yeah.
She was missing her front arms.
Yeah, I saw that.
But they said they micro back when she molts.
Oh, really?
Because even pretty molted. I watched her molt.
Did you? And how'd she make it, okay?
Everything? She did, because if they don't molt properly, it could be bad. You could lose a limb. They could die.
Oh, no.
So she hung upside down, and she molted, and it happened overnight.
We have a mutual friend, Bob Baker from Woodstock.
Yeah, Bob.
He's a commissioner in Xena Company. And it's funny because he does his, you know, morning sunrise. Then we have Heidi with her praying mantis. So it's like watching the Wild Kingdom.
I actually, you know, it's really sad because I had to look up what happens to them in the wintertime.
Oh,
and
what happens?
They could die.
No!
Yeah, it's so horrible. It's like Charlotte's Web. Because the one on my back deck has already laid its egg sac. And she will die now.
Oh, really?
Yeah. She laid her egg sac, and I can see it. Yeah, it's horrible.
Uh-huh.
And I can see so I will watch that egg sac. That's in one of my other shrubs on the back deck there.
in the spring, when the temperature heats up, that egg sac will hatch live praying mantis.
You know what we got invaded with this year at the house in Boodle Hole was hummingbirds.
Oh, they're beautiful.
Oh, my God. They
shouldn't come around my praying mantis.
They're gorgeous. But there must be 15 of them. It's like
you must have some kind of flowering something around.
The trumpet vines on both trellises.
They're beautiful. Yeah, they'll come for that.
Yeah, they come for that. But you sit there, ducking the whole day. But they're just stunning.
I didn't notice these things before because, as you can attest, we're always rushing. Meetings and events. And now I'm just like, I'm on my porch. And I'm checking out my shrubs, apparently.
Are you molting?
Oh, my gosh. I hope I don't. I did molt a little.
I tell you, I like it better.
I went really short with my hair, and clearly I've given up the hair dye,
which
I feel good about. Yeah. You know, that was, I used to use an organic hair dye, but it just wouldn't cover the stubborn grays.
Well, it's just one of those things. It's called. It looks great. You look fabulous.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. John thinks I look great too, right, John?
Give me on record. Yeah. Yes, you do.
We just have to make sure we keep the upbeat, keep the smile. I mean, I feel bad for the parents right now going through this whole school issue. Yeah. What's going on? But we have to keep the upbeat. I hope a lot of people go out to the opera. If they get tickets, I guess it's a ticket situation.
Yeah, you have to go online and get tickets.
But there's so much going on. There's so much stress, different kinds of stress, I should say, in people's lives, especially with children, with school, no school. There's no sports. There is sports. The guidance for this, the guidance for that.
How are parents going to have their kids home when they have to go to work?
That's another thing. I was speaking to Marcy, who does our hair. Your hair individually, pretty soon.
John gets his hair cut right next door at Joe the barber.
Is that right?
Regular Joe's.
And Marcy was suggesting. She says, "Listen, I don't know what to do." I says, "We have to get together with the parents and get these kids together that need socialization." And it's true. Yeah. It's funny. It's a bittersweet of not having skate time because there's so many ideas I have. He had 30,000 square feet. You say to a few parents, here, take, take, 20 square feet, bring in three kids, let them get together, let them do the social stuff.
It's really hard. I look at my daughter, she's just up in her bedroom.
Right.
And it's social media, and she actually Zooms with her friends. She says that's easier because of the connection. But I feel horrible on a daily, typically during the summer, if your kids aren't overly scheduled, which mine never were, they were very resistant to that. But I always knew they're going to be going back to school. It's coming. They're going. But now it's there. There is no. Oh, they're going to go back. I joked and said it used to be Mother's Day when they would go back.
What I think is really came out of this more than anything that I think, and you've done it for years. You went to Lake George. There are people going up, to different places upstate.
I actually only went once this year.
Did you?
It was a little overcrowded up there. Yeah.
I think it's because people are exploring more their own backyard.
They are exploring.
They're not going far, but they're going.
Right.
And this was the first year that we went. We continued our tradition because I have the RV, and town was very, very busy. We only went in for an hour one night, and then I spent the rest of the time in the park.
Warrensburg for a week.
You were there the same time I was.
The same time, and we stayed at a house. We only went into Lake George once, and it was like a morning, scrolling for coffee and then on out because, you do see a lot of traffic, but we enjoyed the house we had.
You guys had a really nice spot too.
They said Lake Placid's got a lot of work of people in. Yeah. So there are quite a number of
people are just trying to do what they can. Yeah. Yeah, it's good, I wasn't I exercised more.
I got to tell you, I don't know what the transition date was, but at one point I said I just gained 10 pounds. Oh.
Mine wasn't just COVID. Mine was the election.
Mine was the COVID. But in the last, I would say, month or so, I took off 7 of it. So I'm on the right track. But I tell you, that
sneaks up on you.
I was always eating. It was like, what am I going to have? I was like getting up and having breakfast. And I would get, around 10 o'clock, I'd be like, what am I going to go make for lunch?
That's all we had to look forward to.
It was crazy.
I put on
10 pounds. That wasn't good. It wasn't good at all. But I got 7 of it off, and I got to keep going now.
Yeah. John, what have you been doing in your COVID time?
Working.
Yeah, you have really been.
Way too much. Honestly, it's been interesting not having that downtime.
You miss meeting us all.
Just being
we used to see
out.
You guys a lot. Yeah. Now, you know, I came out the other night. I've been out twice.
I mean, there was one
Were
thing
you shocked to see me?
I just tried to keep as normal as possible. That was my, like, Wednesday night going out.
Wing night.
Without something that you can look forward to in a week as, like, your go-to getaway type thing.
Now,
everybody's got to find that
now
one thing.
Now, something did
works.
Come up, and I need to ask you about that I really am curious about is – why is mom always babysitting your dogs?
Oh, man. Everybody that doesn't know, I have two German Shepherds. They are, one's the most lovely one possible. The other is a devil. They're both great. My mom gets them. We go up every Sunday, family dinner. And then, like, every other week, I'll have a cleaner come to my house on a Wednesday, and I'll ship the dogs off to,
oh, is that right?
To doggy daycare at my parents. She gets to have them for a day. They're great, though.
Good.
Hey, listen, my dog goes next door to my parents
That's
every
good.
Day.
No, but they should give you some exercise walking them around.
They do. But the younger one, the younger one's a boy. He keeps me on my toes. Every time I come home, he doesn't destroy things, but he'll leave something for me on my living room floor.
Oh, really?
Whether it's a book that he'll take off a shelf, whether it's a cup that he'll take off the countertop. He actually just learned to open a closet door the other day.
Oh, boy.
A garbage pail, small garbage pail. Everything's still in the garbage pail until I get home. So I come up the stairs, and there's the garbage pail full, but he got so excited that he knocked it over.
Oh,
and
funny.
I'm just like, it's something every time.
That's funny. We had Rocket for a while when he was younger. Now he's, you know, we didn't realize we have Rocket 12 years.
Oh.
And we got him when he was 2, so he's 14. But he's still a little pain in the neck. But there was a point, I would say, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, he was bringing stuff home. Birds, mice, chipmunks. It was like, Rocket, stomp already with this nonsense. And we just leave him right in front of the door, by the entrance, on the porch. Yep.
So happy.
Yeah, like, look what I have for
Prize
you.
For you.
Yeah. Oh, it was disgusting.
That's like my cat. He brought something in the house the one morning.
Oh, really? Oh. No, he hadn't done that, thank God. But
in a time like this, animals bring that much more joy to you.
Yeah, they
do. Really, very much so. And that's another thing. I'm grateful for the time I've been able to spend with my dog.
Yeah, and that's funny. I bring Rocket to the lake with me when I go there when I'm working there.
Rocket must be tired of the trip back and forth.
Yeah, he gets there. I have a little blanket for him by the back door, and he stares at the boat. And then every once in a while, he'll get out, do his business, and walk down to the dock and look around and come back. So he's at that age where you can let him out, literally, free. And he knows, you know, where to come back and stuff, but it's
That's
cool.
That's funny.
Yep.
Gotta love our animals.
Yeah.
But I guess you find these things to appreciate during times like this, too.
And I hope more people are, too. You know, that's the other thing. We just have to, you know, pray that people just find their way now. And you know, I hate the words, the new norm. It should be really, you know, what are we doing to reengage ourselves, you know, in a positive way, in a way that, you know, we find new things to do. And I hope we can get past those words, the new norm to be. And the only place where I think we need the norm really is school. And I mean that, you know.
Norm is always changing.
Right. The norm. Thank you, John. That's a very good way to put it.
That's the tough part about calling it the norm is that, like, you see it in your life.
Right.
Things come and go, and new people come, new people leave.
Yeah.
I don't know what school's going to look like.
No, we don't. And
it's interesting. The county, I think, is actually doing a survey because the whole school thing with parents and having their children.
But
with
you
them.
See what it is? It's what's bothering me about it is that you can get to a point like Pat and all these guys and Ryder are going to all take their time and do
and
this
ladies.
Survey and make this survey, and then it's going to get to the school superintendent and the union, and it's going to be like they're going to blow it up. So the efforts are important that the county's doing. But quite frankly, with all the respect to these guys who are putting in all this extra time, all this energy to do all this work for this stuff, can be blown up in a half a second when one superintendent says, well, like, call it Saugerties, call it Roundup, says, well, we really want to risk our people, all the unions get involved. And that just blows everything up because they're their own tax jurisdiction. And quite frankly, there's not that much the county legislators or anybody can do about it.
Correct.
So it's tough. It's a tough, tough gig.
Yeah, that is true.
But I hope that at least maybe they come up with some guidance, the county, that they'll listen to.
It's not the guidance.
Yeah,
it's
that
the
comes
data
down
points.
From the state.
Well,
yeah.
I'm calling local guidance, sure. Maybe.
Just by responding, being involved, communicating your thoughts and your perspective of where you're at and how you're handling things, it's a data point that helps a bigger picture form so that we know how to move forward as a community.
Yeah.
I mean, take a look at it when we respond to any of these social justice or just humanitarian efforts where you have people reaching out, voicing their concerns. It's a data point that speaks to a larger picture,
sure.
that we as a community, we're growing together in a way that we've never actually seen until we've taken this step back.
Yeah. No, but, you know, you look at Kingston, there's so many good things. Terry and I, believe it or not, last Thursday night, she had off Friday. And so we came into just literally just to walk around, went downtown.
What was going on downtown on last Thursday? And maybe it was like last night was not the best weather, but I went through downtown last Thursday. We went to Frozen Rainbow
right.
with Lydia.
I didn't do that yet.
And we were going to go walk the promenade, and I could not find even a spot to park.
It was
like a street festival.
Truthfully, it didn't feel that because we did.
It was last Thursday?
Yeah, I think. I'm positive. Again, because you had Friday off. And it was just a nice night. We grabbed literally, a little food that's down in Savona's, and we ate. And
Lydia couldn't even believe the amount of people.
Really?
Was,
that's interesting.
I mean, it was.
Pardon me, it was Thursday before.
Oh, okay, that's okay.
Yeah, that's what it was.
No problem. Last Thursday, it was a beautiful night, and it was nice to see. And then I said to her, you don't really want to stay, do you? Because I can't find a place to park.
Yeah, it was a beautiful night.
I mean, I was happy for the establishments down there because it was nice. But but other than that, I haven't done too much.
No, but what you have done is quality, in my opinion. And I think that's important, too. You know, I went to the Roost one day.
Oh, yeah.
And I saw Mom. So it's like little things like that really, and we ate outside, my sister.
Yep.
You know, we ate outside. And you almost go to place. Maybe because of my age or whatever, I'm going to the establishments where I have a connection.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, yeah, that's what got me out the other night, too.
Right. I had the connection with Mom. Your mom. So, my sister wanted to go for breakfast. So I said, okay.
Is it Mom at the Roost?
Right,
at
the Roost.
Main Street, Stone Ridge.
Right. And that's what it boils down. It's a place for you. So we sat outside on the thing. You know, we had our social distancing and la, 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 la. And we had a nice breakfast. And
yeah, which yesterday afternoon, I had just gotten home. Was it yesterday? Yeah, yesterday. Oh, I had an appointment. I just got home with Lydia, and I got the alert for the tornado.
Oh, right, exactly.
I'm immediately, my mom's outside serving people. Right. And then, I realized so many establishments are outside serving people, and we had this bad weather pattern that, blew through here. It's just like so many crazy things.
But quite frankly, we were getting these alerts, too, all day long, right? And I'm saying to myself, wait a minute, it's going to Texas, Louisiana, which is devastating. We should all pray for those people.
Yeah.
They're in a world of hurt. But I couldn't figure out how I was, getting to New York from there. And it's like,
I think it was separate.
It was. Yeah. It was a storm coming over the Canadian border or something. But John, it was great to see you, man.
Yeah, thanks so much for coming in, John. Yeah. And
that
again,
was fun today.
A lot of, I just really want to stress the fact that. I don't think a lot of people fully understand. It's okay because you don't need to really know these things unless you've, for me personally, I never knew what the table was like or how absentee ballots got counted until
I barely scratched the surface talking
about
it. We can talk about that all day long, can't we?
It is the truth, but, I just want to make sure that, people listening have faith in our Board of Elections, in the process, and you guys, on both sides, and this speaks for, both commissioners, deputy commissioners, all of the workers there, they're doing their utmost to make sure that the...
He actually does a great job.
They all do a good job.
They
really do.
Sunshine.
And you're there for them. If they have any questions, concerns, they can call you directly. Your office is open if they want to visit as well. And I think, I really don't want people to have too much angst about the upcoming, except you, John. You can have all the angst.
let me bear the burden.
Yeah, exactly.
Truth be told, listen, it's going to, people are going to have angst. You know, and you're going to have both sides say there's going to be voter fraud here and voter fraud there. And, You know, who's going to do that? It's out. It's just done. It's the media. It's a different kind of media. If we just close our ears to it all and just get out there and vote, that's where we're better off doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I thank you all, my friends, for joining me. Thank you, Dan. Have a great weekend.
Thank you, Dan.
Sign
thank you. Thank you so much, Lynn. Okay, and what a good show. And thank Heidi Haynes and Len Bernardo and John Quigley, and a special thanks to Frank McKay for calling in. It's now 8:58, and it is Friday, August 28th, and 66 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. And thank you for being with us here at KCR, participating with us. And we are at AM 920 and 92.5 FM and streaming online at mykcr.org. Talk radio at its best. Inspired discussions about our communities with the community. And we invite you to keep up with us on Facebook, facebook.com/groups KCR920. And KCR's Radiothon continues today to help keep the morning show on the air. We need your help. Please help us reach our goal of $12,000 by calling 331-1004 or send a check to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. This will be the last Radiothon of the year, so please help us stay on the air. Your contributions help keep KCR alive, and the Radiothon will continue till we reach our goal. We invite you to be with us every weekday, 7 to 9 a.m., and until Monday, we wish you every success in growing and developing Kingston and all our neighboring communities. We now return you to Real Country Radio.
Bring it on out to my baby and me.